Hi everybody, it's time for my 2014 bike trip. This year I decided to tour the American Southwest and get a desert experience instead of the Arctic one of the last trip. It seemed like a good idea to start with a 50cc quest ride. 50cc stands for 50 hours coast to coast. So I plan to ride to Jacksonville, Florida and spend the night and leave early in the morning for San Diego. I was convinced that a person could complete the ride in 40 hours if he skipped the overnight stay halfway across the country. One way to find out. I got up early in Jacksonville and had a delicious Grand Slam breakfast, my last meal until I arrived at the West Coast. All my water, sandwiches, and snacks were on the bike so that I could eat while refueling and drink while riding. But before leaving Jacksonville, I needed to visit the beachfront to make it an official coast-to-coast ride. With salt water dripping from my boots, I was... The next day I rested up in San Diego, and in the evening I went over to visit the old town. I left San Diego, crossing the Mojave Desert toward one of my goals, camping in Death Valley. The twisty roads leaving San Diego were just what I needed after spending 2 days on Interstate 10. The Salton Sea is the largest lake in California, created by accident in 1905. In the 60s, it was a resort destination, but by 1975, it was an environmental disaster. Baker is the home of the world's tallest thermometer. Oh, there's a nice looking motel. I'll have to check that out. But there's the thermometer. Too bad it doesn't work. I was in luck. They had a vacancy and there weren't any campgrounds nearby. The room was pure luxury. Well, I think the chair had been used, but I'm not sure what for. While I was in Death Valley, I took some time for a short hike up Golden Canyon. Oh, look, somebody lost a couple of puppies. Maybe I could take one home for my wife. Okay, I found the campground. Now I just need to find a good campsite. Maybe one with lots of shade next to a stream. Rode up to Dante's View. It's 5,500 feet above sea level, looking down on Badwater Basin at 283 feet below sea level. From here, I plan to ride down to Las Vegas and up Nevada's extraterrestrial highway to Rachel. Rachel is just outside the Nellis Air Force Base Test Range, also known as Area 51. There's a little inn that has good food and free camping in Rachel. Then I'll work my way north up to Oregon. Hang on, the roads leading up to Lake Tahoe have a lot of curves, and you know how I feel about that. From Oregon, I'll head south along the California coast. I hope to find lots of redwood forests in addition to the views of the Pacific. This is what I was hoping for, a nice campsite under the redwoods. It was a beautiful place, even though it rained most of the night. The next morning, I left the highway for a small road leading into a redwood park for some good photos. The paved road turned into dirt, which was a bit slick. But the real slippery part of the road was the dark leafy shoulders outside the tracks. As long as I stayed in the middle, I should be okay. I thought I would stop and turn the bike around in the road to pose it for a photo when I lost my footing and it went down. I had to remove all of the luggage and duffel bag before I could pick it up again. From now on, I'll stay in the middle. I'm just glad it's a one-way road. Uh-oh. So it's not a one-way road.
All right, thank you. School bus. Holy cow.
Yeah, here I am riding in the part of the road I said I was going to stay away from. It's like riding on grease. I was starting to have flashbacks of the Dalton Highway again.
A school bus!
The Pacific Coast Highway alternates between redwood forests and ocean views.
We'll be right back.
This is what happens when you build your dream home too close to the ocean. This is the other side of those same houses. You can see the yellow tape and the condemned notices. At Santa Cruz, I headed east, passing over the Sierra Nevada mountains at Yosemite, and then crossing the Nevada desert to Las Vegas again. I know I should have edited out this segment of riding up the mountain on a twisty road. I know most people aren't interested in seeing it. I tried, but I just couldn't cut it out. I kept remembering how much fun it was, so indulge me one more time. Workers are still cleaning up from the Yosemite wildfires of 2013. Since then, new wildfires in September 2014 burned even more. Some hikers had to be rescued from the top of Half Dome by helicopter. If I had done my homework, I would have known that Tioga Pass over Yosemite reaches elevations of nearly 10,000 feet. I would have also known that the pass opened to traffic only 2 hours before I arrived because of what they called a dusting of snow. I may even have known to load up with all of the clothing I had to fend off the bitter cold. But everybody knows a major ingredient of adventure is poor planning. Who am I to fight that tradition?
A little chilly. I'm trying to get to Miami.
My plan was to make it from Santa Cruz to Rachel, Nevada, 500 miles away, and grab another night of free camping. But I spent too much time in Yosemite to make it that far. After crossing over Tioga Pass and a lot of cold desert miles, I arrived at Tonopah, Nevada at sundown. Temperatures were falling, winds were howling, and the only thing on my mind was a hot shower and warm room for the night. So I stopped at the first upscale motel I saw to get a room. Then I found out there wasn't a single vacancy in the entire town because of a big construction project. Did I mention poor planning a minute ago? I finally found someone who told me of a new Motel 6 in the next town. So I made my reservations and headed to Beatty, Nevada, 95 miles away through the cold night. If adventure is caused by poor planning, I think I've had enough for one day. Look closely at the sign. This is the Denny's in Beatty, but everything has a casino attached. My spy cam shows what it's like walking out of Denny's after breakfast. From Las Vegas, I headed east into Utah to see national parks like Zion, Bryce Canyon, and Capitol Reef, and then down into Arizona for Monument Valley, before continuing on to Amarillo. This little hole in the rock is actually a huge window in a tunnel that's been cut through the mountain. Bryce Canyon can't really be seen from the road, so most of the images I brought back are still photos. Sit back and enjoy 3 minutes of the spectacle of Bryce. I had to cross over another high mountain pass on the way to Torrey, Utah. Not only was it cold and windy, the clouds were gathering like they had something serious to say. This seemed like an excellent opportunity to spend the night indoors, and I'm glad I did. It snowed that night and most of the next day. We'll be right back. A local guy told me about an overlook called Muley Point, so I took the 5-mile dirt road to check it out. Route 261 South continues on the valley floor 1,200 feet below. So how do you get down there from up here? The Moki Dugway, that's how. I like campsites away from the crowds, and the one I found at Goosenecks was about as isolated as it could be. Some campers enjoy the park from the top, like us, and others enjoy it from the San Juan River below. I had breakfast in a town named for this rock, Mexican Hat, Utah. I was looking forward to eating at the Big Texan restaurant on Route 66. It's famous for the steak challenge. Eat a 72-ounce steak with potato, salad, shrimp, and roll in less than an hour and it's free. This fellow from New Zealand had a dozen friends cheering him on, but he wasn't able to finish. I played it safe and settled for the 21-ounce sirloin. After Amarillo, I had seen everything I came to see, so I just pounded Interstate 40 for 2 days to get home. Arkansas and Tennessee paid me back for all those days of riding in sunshine.